And welcome to the Retro Gamer Show.
Here's what's coming up on today's show. We take a look at some stamps. We have a games chart flashback for you, but what will be the system, the month and the year? We take a look at some of the new consoles coming out this year that you could be playing your retro games on. And we have our usual roundup of retro gaming events in What's On. It's all going to be just a little bit. So first of all, on today's show, we don't want to talk to you about games. No, we want to talk to you about stamps.
What?
As you may or may not know, the Royal Mail here in the UK have released a set of stamps depicting images from 8 classic video games. On the first class stamp, we have 1992's Sensible Soccer. From 1991, also on the first class stamp, we have Lemmings. On the second class stamp, and from 1984, we have the 3D space trading combat simulator, Elite. Also on the second class stamp is the Amiga classic Worms from 1995. Also from 1995, and on a £1.55 stamp, we have the PlayStation classic Wipeout. Also on a £1.55 stamp, we have the Codemasters Classic Micro Machines from 1991. On the stamp that will cost you £1.60 and taking us back to our ZX Spectrum days in 1987, it's Dizzy. And finally on a £1.60 stamp from 1989, it's Populous that was brought to us from those nice people at Bullfrog. Now if you visit the Royal Mail website, you will find that the Royal Mail have released these stamps in various collector's packs and collector's editions. We decided to go for the limited edition gamer collection pack that comes in this steel tin. On opening the tin, you will find a certificate of authenticity, as apparently only 2,500 of these have been released. And our tin is number 2,324. Next we have a little coloured booklet that has lots of information and facts about the games featured on the stamps. Then finally we have 8 full colour postcards. Each of these has an actual stamp stuck to the top right hand corner, some information about the game, and then a large image of the stamp on the back. We also decided to pick up this presentation pack. It features all 8 stamps in a fold-out design. Again, it's full colour and has some nice images and information about the games. The stamps themselves are down the bottom, placed behind this plastic sheet, which you can pull up and then you can actually take the stamps out if you want to have a closer look at them. Also included as part of this pack are some Tomb Raider stamps. They come stuck to this piece of card and protected by a clear film on the front. The card has an image from the Tomb Raider series on the front, and on the back it has some information about the Tomb Raider series and some concept art. Other items for sale on the Royal Mail website that looked good that we didn't buy was this framed set of stamps, this Tomb Raider collector sheet, and finally this set of postcards.
Ah, I see what you mean now.
Yes, retro gaming stamps.
Yeah, I mean, this case is brilliant.
Yeah, it's really nice. So there's only 2,500 of the tins available.
Ah, and you've got 2,324.
Yeah, I think they've actually sold out now. I don't think they're available on their Royal Mail website anymore.
So it's gone quick then.
Yeah.
Because that's pretty cool.
Us retro gamers will buy anything if it's got a retro game on it. So they thought, let's do some stamps and some special collector's editions to go with it. So
I'm a sucker for anything in a tin.
Yeah, yeah. Of course, that'll go well with your tin games that you can collect. You know, there's all those collector's special editions that come in tins. So go well on the shelf with those.
Yeah, some good games here. And Elite.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's really good. Like that. I actually have a couple of eBays to do.
All right.
So you don't mind, I could use these.
No, not having those, am I? Right then, James, that's enough about stamps. Let's get into some gaming stuff, and it's time for this month's Games Chart Flashback. For this month's Games Chart Flashback, we're going back to a time when, if you went to the cinema, you may have been watching Tom Cruise in Mission Impossible 2. Mel Gibson, Heath Ledger and Jolie Richardson in The Patriot. Or George Clooney and Mark Wahlberg in The Perfect Storm. And riding high at the top of the UK singles chart was 5 featuring Queen with We Will Rock You.
And for this month's chart, we're taking a look at the mighty Sega Dreamcast from the year 2000 and the month of July. Yeah, you can't start a Dreamcast chart without Crazy Taxi, and it's at number 5. This certainly is one of the best pick-up and play arcade games on any system.
At number 4, it was Zombie Revenge from Sega. Now this game is a spin-off from the House of the Dead series, and it didn't go down too well with the reviewers from Next Generation magazine. They rated it just 2 stars out of 5 and stated that it looks great, it plays okay, but you'll be done with it forever in 4 hours. Find a video store and rent it, was their advice.
Here, take this. A man with golden eyes said to give it to you. How did I get myself into this mess?
At 3, it's MDK2. It's a third-person action-adventure game developed by the company BioWare and published by Interplay Entertainment. It got some pretty good reviews as well, with IGN giving it 9.4 out of 10.
At number 2, it was V Rally 2 Expert Edition. Now, the only difference we can find between the Championship Edition and the Expert Edition is that the Expert Edition had an extra car. If you know differently, if you know more differences than we'd like to know, so let us know in the comments. The game was developed by Eden Studios and published by Infograms. Interestingly, in North America, the game was called Test Drive V Rally.
Medium right, very long, open. Medium left, very long, tighten.
And at number 1, we were still waiting for doors to open in Resident Evil Code Veronica. I'm sure those doors opening were just to brighten up the loading times. I don't really need to tell you guys much about this game, other than this was the latest installment of the long-running survival horror game. It's been said by many that this is one of the greatest games on the Dreamcast, and it truly deserves the number one position.
So there you go, that's this month's Game Chart Flashback. Now, if that is one of your favourite parts of the show, we've got some exciting news for you, because you can now get Game Chart Flashback in print.
And I've got it here!
Yes, we are now doing a series of Game Chart Flashback for Fusion Magazine, starting in the Christmas issue. There it is in all its glory. And some of you may have already seen this and read it. And if you haven't, you can get yourself a copy of the Christmas issue. But we're also in issue 10, which is the latest issue. It's just gone on sale just last week. So you can get yourself a copy of that and read some more Game Chart Flashback. And if you want to get yourself a copy, we'll leave a link to where you can get it in the video description.
Right, moving on. You may have heard that there's a whole bunch of new consoles promised this year. We decided to take a look at a few.
Later this year, we know that the Xbox Series X and PlayStation 5 are being released, and that both systems will be backwards compatible in one way or another. But what new systems are being released this year specifically for playing retro games on? We decided to take a look. First up, we have the Evercade, a brand new handheld console designed specifically for retro games. The system uses unique multi-game cartridges, with several cartridges featuring games from Namco, Atari and Interplay being available from launch. The console has HDMI out, so you can play it plugged into your TV as well as handheld, and on the whole, judging from these clips, it looks to be good. The only thing that might hold this console back is, do we all want to buy the same games that we've already bought several times before yet again? The Evercade has been on its way for a while now, but should now finally be released in late March or early April, with the standard starter pack costing a reasonable $59.99 and a premium edition costing $79.99 and additional games cartridges priced at $14.99. It would definitely be interesting to see how this console does when it finally gets released. Next, another console that seems to have been a long time coming that is still said to be being released this year, the Polymega. This is a modular system that the main base system will let you play CD-based games for original PlayStation, TurboGrafx CD, Sega CD, Neo Geo CD and Sega Saturn. If you want to play cartridge based games, you then buy further add on modular elements. They will let you play NES, SNES, Genesis Mega Drive and TurboGrafx 16 games. Each of these modules will come as a set that will include a low latency wired controller compatible with its designated system and 5 preloaded games. This system looks great and sounds like a good idea, but with the base station costing at launch $299 and each module set costing an extra $59, you're going to need deep pockets if you want a system you can play games on from all your retro gaming consoles. Still, this will be another system we'll be interested to see how it does once released. Coming in March, we have a console I know a lot of us are looking forward to, and that's the TurboGrafx Mini. The TurboGrafx and PC Engine can be expensive consoles to collect for, so the Mini is going to give a lot of us a chance to experience some of the system's great games legally for the first time. 50 games will be included with the system when it launches, and we're sure it's going to look great hooked up to modern TVs. Said to be coming at some point in 2020 is the Analog Pocket. This is coming from the same company that have already released the Mega SG and the Super NT. The Pocket will play Game Boy, Game Boy Color and Game Boy Advance games out of the box. But that's not all, with additional cartridge adapters you will also be able to play Game Gear, Neo Geo Pocket Color, Atari Lynx and more. The Pocket is designed around a 3.5-inch, 615 pixels per inch LCD, with 10 times the resolution of the original Game Boy. Like the Mega SG and Super NT, the Pocket will use FPGA technology, which means no emulation. If you want to play your handheld cartridges on a TV screen, then there's the Analog Dock, which outputs the Pocket's image directly to your HD TV, much like the Nintendo Switch. This system looks great, but of course is going to come at a price, with the Pocket being priced at $199.99 when launched, and then you've got to also buy the dock on top. So that's a quick look at four consoles that should be released in 2020 that will interest retro gamers. But with the amount of mini and clone consoles being released over the past few years, there will no doubt be a few surprises and a few consoles coming out this year that we're yet to hear about. For example, there was footage of a Hyperkin early N64 prototype clone at E3 last year that might just see a release, and who's to say that Nintendo aren't working on an N64 Mini themselves that will be out in time for Christmas. So there you go, some new consoles that are coming out this year, or should be coming out this year. So a couple of them have been a long time coming, as we say. James, would you be buying any of those or looking to get any of those, or are you going to stick to original hardware and emulation?
I do prefer original hardware. There's people that have hacked Vitas and PSPs that can play a lot of the games that are featured. But the Xbox looks pretty good. I'll probably get that. Whether or not it launch, I don't know. If there's a killer app that comes out with it, then probably will. But a bit sort of disappointed with the shape. I would have preferred it more like the Xbox shape, just because most people's TV units...
It's not going to fit under the shelf very well. It's not going to fit on my shelf, I know, so...
More and more like a PC, because everyone knows, isn't it? It's just a PC. Yeah. It looks pretty good.
Yeah, so I think I'm quite interested in the TurboGrafx Mini, although I've got a TurboGrafx, and I've also got a Molycot for it. So, got all the games already, really. Yeah. So, But it looks really good. Just have a small version of that might be quite cool. And also the analog Game Boy sort of thing that they're doing. That looks really nice and really cool. Bit expensive, but...
All their stuff is, isn't it?
Yeah, but it looks really nice. And I'm sort of quite interested in see where that goes. Probably wait and see what happens when it's released. Mm. Right, that's nearly it. But as always, to round things off, it's time for this month's What's On. First up this month then, it's Guildhall Games Fest. This is being held in Portsmouth on Saturday the 1st and Sunday the 2nd of February. For more information on this one and to buy your tickets, get yourself over to guildhallgamesfest.com.
but also on the 1st of February, if you're anywhere up north in Leeds, there's the Marriott Hotel Retro Games Fair. And to find out all the information, go and visit retrogamesfair.com.
Next up, an event in London that apparently happens on the first Friday of every month. It's Unwind Retro that takes place at the West Bank Arts Club in Notting Hill. So with it taking place on the first Friday of every month, you probably wouldn't be surprised to find out that the next event is being held on Friday the 7th of February. To get your early bird tickets and to find out more information about this, we'll head over to unwind.shoobs.com.
And up next, we've got the Milton Keynes Gaming Market being held on Saturday the 8th of February at the Stationbury Leisure Centre. Now this event is super easy to find. Just go left at the first roundabout, then second exit on the second roundabout. On the third roundabout, go all the way around, third right. Next roundabout, go left. Next roundabout, go left again. And then finally, the next three roundabouts, keep going left and you'll be there. For more information on this event, do check our link in the video description.
And finally, rounding off this month, now that we're all quite clear on how to get to the Milton Keynes Gaming Market, it's Play Expo Margate. This is taking place on the 21st and 23rd of February at the Margate Winter Gardens. Expect all your usual Play Expo gaming highlights and more. To order your tickets and to get more information, visit the link in our video description. Right, so there we go, that's this month's What's On, the events that are going to be happening up and down the country this month. Hopefully you can get yourself along to some of those. But that really is all we've got time for this month, James.
It certainly is, but do leave us a comment. Tell us what you're excited about console-wise that are coming out later this year, as well as anything else about the Retro Gamer Show.
Yeah, and if you commented on last month's show, then your name will be going across the bottom of the screen as we speak. And of course, we'll be back next month with another show. So until then, what have they got to do, James?
Keep it retro, everyone.